Well, good morning, virtual visitors. Emma and I will be taking you out on a tide pool walk. It is low tide here in Glacier Bay National Park, and as you can see, I am standing in the midst of an intertidal area. This area is filled with life that depends upon the tides, but at low tide, they still remain in this area, and that's what we're going to explore today. You can do this at home. Just find a place that is influenced by the tide if you live by the coast, but almost any area you can explore virtually. I'd like to just go through some tide pool etiquette, and these are just some rules that pay respect to the creatures that we will be interacting with. The first rule is explore tide pools from the edge, and you can see I am standing on the edge of a tide pool right in front of me, and I am going to keep to the edge. I'm not going to walk through the middle of the pool because that will disturb life that lives in these tide pools. The second etiquette rule that I will make sure I enforce is step on bare rocks wherever possible. And this is very important in the intertidal zone because many areas are covered with life, but also algae or seaweed grow in many of these areas, and it is very slippery. So I want to take care of myself, but I also want to take care of the animals around me. The third one is when I'm turning over a rock, I want to be careful. If you look very closely at a lot of these rocks in the intertidal zone, they are covered with creatures. Barnacles and mussels live upon these rocks. So if I'm going to turn over a rock, I want to be careful of the life on both sides and if I flip it over. And then one of the rules, I don't have it written up here, but if I turn over this rock, when I am finished exploring, I will turn it back and leave it back in place because the creatures living under there need that shelter. The fourth rule that I will follow is that never force an animal free of its foothold or where it's stationed. And that is best shown with the barnacles. Barnacles glue themselves to the rocks, so I'm not gonna force the barnacles off the rock itself. A good test is if you just touch the creature and wiggle it a little bit. If it's free, you can pick it up. If it's not free, you just leave it there. And then the fifth rule that I will follow in my tide pool etiquette is whenever I'm going to touch a creature, I will wet my hands with the water itself. So I'm gonna wet my hands if I'm gonna touch the barnacles or the mussels or even some of the creatures lower down in this region. I just wanted to remind you, besides the tide pool etiquette, during these times, we also practice our social distancing, and please follow your local guidelines concerning COVID-19.
Welcome to Bartlett Cove, an area affectionately known as the Cut and a great place to go tide pooling. I'm excited to explore this area today, hoping to see some titans, maybe some sea stars, and anything else we might discover. Blind ones. Yep. Oh, here's a. Oh, something flicked. There's a sculpin or something in here, and a sea cucumber. So we turned over this rock, and there's a few different things down here. Some sort of sea cucumber, and it looks like there might be a mass of eggs right next to it. So we'll want to turn this back over soon. A line chitin, and I believe a gumboot chitin. And perhaps some limpets covered with barnacles. And then also a couple sea stars, including a six-legged sea star right there. Sea stars can have any number of legs, usually five, but it can go all the way up to 50 in some species.
Down below in the water here, we have a sea anemone with its tentacles out. Sea anemones are living creatures, even though they look like a flower, and sea anemones are closely related to sea jellies. With the tentacles, that this creature is just waiting for something to blunder into its tentacles. Should something touch its tentacles, the tentacles have these microscopic nematocysts, or stinging cells, that will harpoon that creature, and then it will suck it down into the middle of the creature's area, or the middle of its tentacles, and that's where its mouth is. So this is the sea anemone, And the common name for this sea anemone is the Christmas sea anemone because of its red and green coloration. That's the six-legged.
Oh, here's a pretty good, no sea stars. Oh. So here's some purple and green urchins, some more lined chitons. You can see those little plates on their back. They actually have about eight of them.
So during my tide pool etiquette, we talked about don't force a creature off of its hold fast. And one good example of that is the Okra Sea Star. They cling with their tube feet to substrates. If it was on a rock, it would be very hard to remove it. But here's one in the water that has small rocks. And I'm picking the Okra Sea Star up and picking up the rocks that it's holding on to as well. So if it's on a sandy substrate, it's very easy to pick up these creatures. These creatures are the predators in the intertidal zone, and what they prey upon are small shellfish, sea urchins, blue mussels, and also barnacles. And here we have the Okra Sea Star with an open mussel shell. It probably fed upon that creature a while ago. Besides the animal life, we do have some plant life in this area, and they're all in the algae grouping. This green algae is often referred to as sea lettuce. It is loose, it comes off loose, but it's very translucent, the beautiful green coloration. And I've heard that this is edible, but yeah, you do have to wash it off, but here in the park, I'm not going to feed upon it. I'm gonna leave it for the creatures. Other types of algae or seaweeds people refer to, we have this brown one, and this is called seersucker kelp. It has that seersucker texture on the frond itself. And then I believe this one is called Alaria. Has a very reinforced midrib, and it's very fine or delicate fronds on both sides of that. We do have some Coraline algae. The pink algae is very hard. It's not very flowing like these other algaes, but the pink Coraline algae adheres directly to the rocks. And I can pick up the rock, use some of that Coraline algae. All right. And it's this material right here. Looks like it's a lichen attached to the rock, but this is an algae going here. So it's always fun and exciting even to turn over the algae because you might find some creatures amongst the algae itself.
So you can see some examples of some very small line chitons, a small sea star as well, and at the top of the rock there a little bit of that red coralline algae, and that's what the chitons eat. They have some teeth on the bottom of their body, that part that's attached to the rock there, called radula, that scrape away at that very hard red algae. So their food and shelter are right in the same spot right there on that rock.
So one exciting way to look at the creatures in the intertidal zone is to bring a plastic container with you. And I put some creatures in here that I found in the kelp, and these are sea urchins. And sea urchins feed directly on the kelp. This is their main food source. Sea urchins, and they're very easy or delicate to pick up. They do not attach too heavily to the substrate. But sea urchins, many people will call them pin cushions because covering their body are the spines. Sea urchins do feed upon the kelp. They are grazers. They're very similar to cattle in the intertidal zone. But their mouth is on the underside of their bodies. And if I flip this body over of the sea urchin, their mouth is right in the center of their shell or their protective coating. Their mouth is divided into five parts, and I have one that I found earlier today from a dead sea urchin. It's on my Tupperware container. And the way it works is very similar to your hand or your fingers, and the five pieces would come together. Many naturalists refer to the mouth of the sea urchin as Aristotle's lantern, and I think that's probably in reference to its shape or the way it looks. So we can get a close look at the mouth part of the sea urchin. One of the creatures that shows a lot of action in the intertidal zone is the hermit crabs. And hermit crabs are called the hermit crabs because they seem to be always on the lookout for a new home. They need seashells or snail shells to protect the back of their body. And this is also a great use of these plastic tubs, because when you pick up a hermit crab, they sort of pull their body into the seashell, so they don't show much action in my hand. But should I put it into a little drop of water, a little pool of water, they will quickly start becoming active. And as I say that, they are both in their shell. Ooh, here comes one out, and he will start walking around. What we're looking at right now are baby barnacles. And they are referred to as spat, but the baby barnacles, they're looking for a place to settle down. And this is one of the creatures that we will not disturb in the intertidal walk. Barnacles, we have some right here in front of me. These are more adult, but they permanently glue themselves to the rock themselves. So I'm not gonna scrape these off. I'm not gonna try to pick them up. We're just gonna enjoy them from a distance, but you can touch them. At low tide, they shut themselves up, but at high tide, when the water covers this, they will extend their feet, and they will use their feet to filter out the water and to draw food into their mouths. We have a creature on the other side of this rock called a whelk, and it is a predator. It's feeding upon the barnacles, and I'm going to see if it's loose enough to dislodge so I can show the camera. Oh yes, it came off pretty easily. The whelk is a type of snail, and this is a carnivore. They will feed upon the barnacles and the mussels in the intertidal zone. Snail, he has pulled his body into side, and he has his operculum blocking the entrance. This is a predatory snail known as the whelk.
And you can also really see on their body that star shape of that central area. Sea stars move at a variety of different speeds. This is one of the faster ones. But you can see how with those super flexible legs, it really moves. They have little suction cups underneath their feet, and they use those to help pull themselves along.
Hi, this is Ranger Steve, and I'd like to thank you for joining us on this virtual intertidal walk. We'll see you in the future.
Thank you so much for joining us today for this virtual exploration. We hope you enjoyed it. Please let us know in the comments what you really enjoyed or what you're excited about, or post any questions you have as well. If you want to see more, let us know. Thanks for joining us.